A new record-breaking DDoS attack, a magical packet attack for Linux, and stealing cryptographic keys from AMD and Intel CPUs. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse, and this is ThreatWire for June 21st, 2022. This is your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. I am feeling so much better this week, so thank you so much for joining me. I have a merch alert, which you previously heard about if you watched the last couple of episodes. I have about 20 of these left, so I will mention them until they're completely sold out. This is the ThreatWire SAO Totem Board. It's this electronic board, which is powered by micro USB that can be used to power these teeny tiny devices called simple add-ons. These are limited edition. Once they sell out, they are gone for good. So get them while you can from my personal shop, which is snubsy.com/shop, also linked down below in the comments. Thank you so much for supporting my content in whichever way you do it. I truly appreciate it. So let's go ahead and get started with today's news. The record-breaking DDoS attack that I reported on a few months ago is no longer the record-breaking DDoS attack. Cloudflare reportedly mitigated the most record-breaking HTTPS DDoS attack ever recorded about a week ago. According to their report, this attack hit 26 million requests per second, which makes it the largest on record. Now, the attack stemmed from cloud service providers rather than residential ISPs, which leads Cloudflare to believe that the attackers are using hijacked VMs and servers, not IoT smart home devices. Now, it attacked a customer using Cloudflare's free plan. The last two major attacks that the company disclosed hit 17.2 million requests per second and 15 million, so this one is about 10 million more in comparison. This amounted to more than 212 million HTTPS requests in less than 30 seconds from 1,500 networks in over 100 countries, but most of these were from Indonesia, the US, Brazil, Russia, and India. What makes this interesting is not just the speed of the attack, but also the size. Now, usually DDoS attacks require huge amounts of infected botnet devices, those IoT and smart home devices, like the one that required 730,000 devices, but it only hit at 1 million requests per second, mainly because each of those devices is relatively weak in power. This one, on the other hand, used less devices at about 5,000, but they were more powerful servers or virtual machines. So this attack was about 4,000 times stronger. The attack took place over HTTPS, which is generally more expensive than one using the HTTP protocol. Linux has been hit with a slew of attacks in the last week, including ones dubbed Panchan P2P, which is a botnet that spreads using stolen SSH keys and is used to install crypto mining malware. There was also Symbiote, which is a Linux backdoor discovered back in November that is used to infect financial institutions, and it stays very well hidden. And then we have Syslog-K, which is the newest one that I will be talking about here. Now, Syslog-K is a Linux kernel rootkit, which is based on Undor NG, and it has been found in the wild under development. It hides a malicious payload within it that is triggered remotely by an attacker when it sees this specifically crafted network traffic packet. Undor NG is an open source rootkit that's been around since 2004, so it's not new, and it gives attackers the ability to hide processes and modules while they gain full control over an infected machine. Syslog-K hides itself from networking tools like Netstat while it inspects TCP packets to find a source port number, which is 59318, which triggers it to launch malware, which is called Recoup. Now, this malware is a fake SMTP server, and it creates a shell once it receives this very special command. The attacker, from any remote location in the world, can send this specifically crafted TCP packet to trigger the malware to start up a backdoor shell, giving them access to the infected machine and the network. The attacker can also send a command to close the backdoor at any time as well. So according to Avast, who discovered this attack, these are known as magic packets because they have a special format and special powers. In this implementation, an attacker can trigger actions without having a listening port in the infected machine, such as the commands are, in some way, magically executed in the system. They also said even if it is found during a network port scan, it still seems to be a legitimate SMTP server. Currently, this malware only works on older versions of the Linux kernel, but since it is under active development, that could change. Avast also warns that kernel rootkits are harder to detect because they run on that privilege layer. Currently, this malware only works on older versions of the Linux kernel, but since it is under active development, that could change at any time. Avast also warns that kernel rootkits are harder to detect because they run on a privilege layer, so system admins should be aware of these potential attacks and take proper steps to protect systems. Biggest of shoutouts to my Hush Puppy Perk level patrons for sharing their fur baby photos and for the support. These are adorable, I love them. Thank you so much for sending them in. And a huge thank you to Benjamin, who joined the Alliance on patreon.com/ThreatWire. Let's go ahead and finish out today's episode with my last top story, which is all about stealing crypto keys from CPUs. Attackers could steal entire cryptographic keys using this new side channel attack, which is called Hertzbleed. Sounds like heartbleed, I wonder why. It allows them to detect variations in CPU frequency using something called dynamic voltage and frequency scaling, or DVFS. Now, DVFS throttles the CPU, so they don't go over their thermal or power limitations whenever they are under high usage load. It also reduces the power consumption. Modern Intel and AMD CPUs are affected by this attack because of how they use this dynamic scaling. The adjustments are translated into execution time differences, and an attacker could use the time variations to extract information such as those cryptographic keys. Hertzbleed, which was disclosed by researchers at the University of Texas at Austin, University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, and the University of Washington, prove that power side channel attacks can be turned into timing attacks remotely, as explained by the researchers on their website. They also pointed out that this attack shows how cryptographic code could leak via remote timing analysis, and this affects modern x86 CPUs. The attack is tracked as CVE-2022-24436 for Intel and 23823 for AMD. Intel and AMD both disclose that this affects their processors and it can be exploited with rather low privileges. The researchers have not confirmed if their proof of concept works on other vendors as well. AMD and Intel both have stated that they do not intend to release any patches because they don't believe the attacks would be practical outside of a lab environment. That's what Intel said. Now, they do provide mitigation assistance though by explaining that developers can use masking, hiding, or key rotation to protect against power analysis-based frequency side channel attacks. Also, the researchers do say if you have Turbo Boost on Intel or Turbo Core or Precision Boost on AMD CPUs turned on, you can disable that feature as it's basically DVFS with this user-friendly name. Keep in mind though, that may impact your PC's performance, and Intel stated the attack could still happen even if you disable this feature. Make sure to check out my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/ShannonMorse, where I just posted two videos about all these really cool upcoming Android technology features that are going to be introduced this year. It's super exciting. Don't forget to like and subscribe to Hack5, and thank you so much for helping us reach 800,000 subscribers. I'm Shannon Morse, and I will see you next time on the internet.